You can win every Oscar there is known to man.
Okay. Bye.
last time we talked, you'd made a film starring a non-actor who you had a good time with, but was very young. Here you are with one of the biggest movie stars in the world, and this really is your first kind of, I mean, you've had French movie stars, but not really of this size. Is that a change of concept? Is that a choice?
No. We didn't change our way to work, but we wanted to work with a star, with a big actress, and Marion is that. And for us it was a challenge. Are we able or not to work with a star, a big actress, and are we able to do for her in our family, in our characters? And when we met Marion told us, I desire to work with you. And we desire to work with her, with you. And it was the same desire, the same enthusiasm to work together. And she wanted to lose her pictures from the other movies and of the mode, of the fashion. And it was, for us, it was very important. And I think we researched a lot of before the shooting. And I think it's in the rehearsal we can, it's that we can transform Marion. We find another, a new body, a new look, a new appearance, a new a new way to move, to look at something. And when we rehearsal 5 weeks, at the end we find the crossing, the meeting between Marion and Sandra. And when we rehearsal, we shoot with a video camera, like your camera. And every evening we show, we watch our work. And after three days, 4 days, we saw it was okay with Marion and Sandra. It's she became Sandra, and I think it's because Marion worked alone before with music, with a lot of things. But it's, if you meet Marion. Marion will explain that. But for us, after 3 days, 4 days, we realized it was Sandra. She was Sandra, and she walked, she falls, she looked, she hold the phone. Like another, like Sandra, like our Sandra in our imagination. Yeah, it was very important. The rehearsals are very, very important for us.
So does that happen in all of your movies? Does that happen much, where you have a kind of preordained idea of how you see the character, and that's what you get? Or do actors usually, or non-actors, or whomever, change it as you know? Does that change your view?
But it's a mixture. That's a mixture, because if you choose an actor, it's because you are waiting for something, and his presence, or her presence in this case, is unique. And you choose Marion because her presence is unique, and this this Sandra is unique because it's an encounter between our character and an actress. And we worked together. And at the end of this kind of work, mm-hmm. She became step by step somebody else. And it was because it's not we are not nous n'avons pas décidé avant. On ne s'enferme pas, non.
We haven't, you know, locked ourselves into a preconceived idea prior.
On peut dire que c'est le processus de travail qui fait qu'à un moment donné la rencontre a lieu. C'est les répétitions, c'est ce processus de répétition qui fait que qui fait naître cette rencontre entre le caractère et la comédienne.
It's the rehearsal process that allows the birthing of the character and the melding of the actress
it's
with the character.
It's not only our decision. It's not only the decision of Marion. It's the work in progress. Decide. Finally.
Yeah, and Marion was extraordinary because before shooting, she told us, "You can do what you want, whatever you want, with me." Well, it's easy to say that to them, but on the set, it's not the same, and it was true. It was true. She was very open for our proposition, and she worked every day, every evening, to find Sandra. It was for us, huh? Because sometimes, well, when you meet a big actress, yes, she said that is normal, but she promised that, but il faut tenir la promesse.
But she can't. I mean, a lot of actresses may say that, but they don't deliver.
Yeah. But it was true. And so thank you, Marion.
So was the choice that you wanted a big actress for this because the material? Was it the juxtaposition of somebody with fame and power and money against this character that has none and is at the end of their rope? Was that intentional?
Est-ce que c'était exprès que vous avez choisi quelqu'un qui avait cette image, ce pouvoir, qui était tellement connu et qui était en juxtaposition avec un personnage qui était au bas de l'échelle, si on peut dire?
Yeah. But,
est-ce que vous avez fait exprès?
Bon, it's like this. Yes, you're right. When you see from outdoor, you see that, you see, that a star and somebody of the working class. Mm-hmm. Oh, strange. But it's not really true because when we met Marion for the first time, it was not for this character, it was for another character. Our goal, it was to work with Marion, and we knew Marion was a big star and a great actress. And our challenge is how it's possible to make Marion to come here in our family, and how it's possible qu'elle enrichisse cette famille.
You know, how would it possible? How can we make her integrate her into our family, and how can she enrich it?
This so you guys were, it was really about her, not about a star, it was about Marion. Yeah?
C'était axé, c'était pas le fait qu'elle était une star, c'était le fait qu'elle était Marion et qu'elle avait...
Yeah. We say, when we met Marion, it was a love at first sight between us. Well, cinematographic love, but not true love. But it's a kind of love, you know.
But she's married to a director, so...
I don't know if it's interesting. I'm not sure.
No, man. Because without that, we can work with somebody. Huh. We need that to work. We needed to meet her in person, in the flesh, not just on the picture. It was very important for us. And when we met her, it was very... after 10 seconds, it was okay. It was... we desire to work with you.
Have you guys met with other name actors who are not so
No.
Ever?
Just Marion.
No. Because maybe with the voice of God, it will be more it will be easier. Lorsqu'on a rencontré Marion pour la première fois, c'était pour un autre rôle.
You know, when we met Marion for the first time, we had another role in mind.
Et quand on s'est quitté, on s'est remis au travail autour de cet autre rôle. C'était un personnage de médecin. Et on n'est pas arrivé à développer l'histoire. Et c'est Sandra qui est un personnage, une histoire qu'on avait abandonnée, qui est revenue dans notre dos sous les traits de Marion, en disant, hey, les gars, Sandra, moi je suis ici, on pourrait recommencer à travailler avec moi, non?
So after we met her, we went back to working on the screenplay that we were working on with this other character, and it wasn't gelling, it just wasn't coming together. And all of a sudden, from the background, emerging out of the closet, this character that we had worked on way back, another story, emerged. And when she emerged under the traits of Marion.
Et Sandra n'a jamais eu d'autre visage que celui de Marion pour nous.
And Sandra never had another face except Marion's for us.
When you look at Marion, at the face of Marion a long time, you see somebody who is there and who is not there. Mm-hmm. She is, you know, vulnerable, melancholic, a little melancholic. Mm-hmm. It's okay.
Melancholic. Yeah.
Melancholic.
Yeah.
And when she wants, she's there. And after the scene of the hospital in the film, in mm-hmm. 2 Days, 1 Night, she's there. And her husband is behind. Mm-hmm. He's before her. And it's very strange because you travel in her face. Mm. You know?
Mm-hmm. That's kind of been her. Kind of the magic of her from the, I mean, for what we've seen in America, we didn't see the Taxi movies and whatever, but I think I Dare You to Love Me, but it was something like that, where the two, they dare each other, these higher and higher, it's a love story, and they dare each other to do crazier and crazier things, to the point where they kill each other at the end, and that was the first time we really saw her in the U.S., and there was already that kind of distance, but that intimacy at the same time was intriguing.
Distance and intimacy at the same time. Yes. Good.
So would Sandra have been on a different journey had you written the story earlier? And then when you were working on the other screenplay, was the journey similar, or I mean that she goes to in this film, or?
Est-ce que la trajectoire de Sandra aurait été différente si vous l'aviez écrit avant l'avoir rencontrée? Avant Est-ce que l'autre personnage suivait un trajectoire qui était similaire à celui de Sandra?
No, because when she came out of the cupboard, the story we have only the beginning of the story, mm-hmm. and it was only a beginning. The only one journey is the. Is the journey of the film?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Well, after the meeting after meeting Sandra, mm-hmm. Marion.
Yes. What was it about? So, in terms of the story itself in the film, is it for you guys? Is it of the moment? Is it a story that you feel is timeless? Because I mean, I know we saw it. I saw it in Cannes, and it felt very much of the moment for even America. We were going through a lot of this in the U.S., and that seems to it kind of changed over the last 6-8 months. The tone of it in America has changed. And, you know, the question of these issues may not have changed in France. But is this kind of a forever story, or is this, do you think, of the moment?
Bon, est-ce que cette histoire pour vous est une histoire qui est vraiment d'actualité, ou est-ce qu'elle est intemporelle?
Both. Both. Yes, both. Mm. We hope.
Both, because... I think that's also a portrait of our time, this lack of solidarity, and the ethical journey of Sandra. Mm-hmm. I hope it could be timeless.
Yes, I think, because when we wrote the script, we noticed that there is a dialogue, a ringing dialogue, a dialogue qui revient souvent.
Oh, repetitious.
Ronald Reagan or
no.
Yes, a dialogue, the same dialogue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Comes and comes in the film. It's can you put you in my shoes.
Can you put yourself in my shoes?
Yeah. Yourself in my shoes. And when wrote that, we find the end of the film, because she became the same that a co-worker, because she, if she want, she can take the place of another, and she refused. And for us, it's the question of the film, it's a question for to the viewer, to the audience. We hope the, and it's intemporal, it's not, it's timeless. We hope the spectator, the viewer, ask him, tell him, or tell her, and me, can I take, can I put my shoes in his place or not? And this question is not just for today, it's for, I hope, it's for tomorrow, and it's a moral, ethical question without a time very precise.
Because the intimacy of it, I mean, the way you've gone about telling this, you could almost put it in other genres. This could be a war movie, this could be a comedy, it could be all kinds of things that where people, the idea that there's this constant kind of confrontation with people trying to just figure out where they stand, where they, what they believe, and how they're going to express it.
C'est que ça pourrait être mis dans beaucoup de contextes, un film de guerre, une comédie, où les gens doivent constamment se mettre à la place des autres pour se poser des questions.
Yeah.
Ça pourrait être quelque chose qui se met dans toutes sortes de cadres.
Donc, like our interview. We speak about the film, but we speak English. It's a kind of comedy. You have two different directions for your movie.
Yeah. Well, I'm pretty sure by the time in 2 years from now, when you come back for another film, you'll be speaking better English than me.
I have a good joke about that, but I prefer to tell the joke in French, because non, mais sur le fait de se mettre à la place de l'histoire de Bloch. C'est une histoire qui est racontée par un philosophe qui s'appelle Hans Bloch, qui était un philosophe allemand qui a émigré, qui a fui le nazisme.
It's a story that's told by a philosopher, Hans Bloch, who escaped the Nazis.
Et il est venu vivre ici jusqu'en 47 aux États-Unis.
And he came to the States to live in the States until 47.
Et il raconte une histoire qui se passe à New York dans le début des années 50.
So he tells a story that takes place in New York in the early 50s.
Le racisme était très présent.
Where racism was very present.
Envers les Noirs.
And towards blacks.
Et c'est un représentant de commerce qui vient. Normalement, il doit venir à Philadelphie. Il arrive à New York et le train pour Philadelphie est déjà parti. Donc, il doit loger à l'hôtel à New York.
So he's a business representative who's, traveling salesman, and the train has already left, so he has to stay in the hotel in Philadelphia.
Il trouve un petit hôtel à New York.
C'est à New York.
Oui, parce qu'il devait aller à Philadelphie.
Oh, he was supposed to go to Philadelphia. He was supposed to go to Philadelphia, and he got stuck in New York, so he finds a little hotel.
Bon, un petit hôtel à New York, dans une petite rue, bon, et là, le groom le conduit dans sa chambre. Et dans la chambre, il y a déjà un noir qui dort.
So there, the valet takes him up to his room, and there's already a black guy that's sleeping in his room.
Et alors, lui, il dit, ça je peux pas, moi, dormir dans la même chambre. Ben, il dit, monsieur, il n'y a pas d'autre.
So he says, I can't sleep in the same room. Well, sir, there's no other room. You don't have a choice.
Alors, il dit, bon, ben alors, s'il n'y a que ça, d'accord, d'accord. Je vais mais n'oubliez pas, il faut venir me réveiller à 5 heures du matin. Et moi, je suis celui qui dort près de la fenêtre, pas celui qui dort près du mur.
And he says, okay, well, if I don't have a choice, that's what I have to do. But I'm the one who's going to be sleeping next to the window. I don't want to sleep next to the door. And you need to wake me up at 5 a.m.
Okay. Et alors il est là et il se met dans son lit et puis il dit le noir et tout ça près de lui, il préfère aller un peu dans le bar. Il dit, j'en ai marre d'être ici avec ce gars, je vais aller un peu m'amuser en bas, dans le bar.
Okay, so he gets into bed and then he says, you know, I'm sort of, I don't really like being next to this black guy in bed, so I'm going to go down to the bar.
Et alors il va dans le bar et là il commence à s'amuser, il y a du jazz, Armstrong, etc. Et les gens imitent Armstrong avec la trompette et tout. Et alors il y en a un, à un moment donné, ils boivent beaucoup, et il y en a un qui le maquille avec un bouchon brûlé, il lui met du noir. Pour s'amuser.
So, you know, he goes down to the bar and it's, you know, kind of got nice ambiance. There's jazz playing, Louis Armstrong, all kinds of other stuff. And at that point, there's a guy who takes cork and does blackface on him.
Bon, et il est tellement sous que les autres le portent dans sa chambre et vont le mettre sur son lit.
So he's so drunk that they carry him up to his room and they put him on the bed.
Et à 5 heures du matin, le groom arrive et le réveille, lui.
So 5 a.m., the groom gets there,
il met
he wakes him up, he puts his clothes on.
Il court vite vers la gare, et là il arrive, il y a son train qui va partir, mais heureusement il arrive, il saute dans le
runs
train
to the
pour Philadelphie.
Gets there, the train's about to leave, jumps on the train, gets to Philadelphia.
Et puis, bon, il est assis, et il va dans les toilettes pour un peu se refaire, regarder son visage, se changer.
So he's sitting and he decides to go to the men's room to sort of clean up a little bit.
Et quand il voit son visage, on the mirror, il se dit, merde, ils ont réveillé le noir à ma place.
And so, when he sees himself in the mirror, he goes, oh shit, they woke up the black guy instead of me.
Donc, ça veut dire que cet homme, une fraction de seconde, il était devenu un noir. Il était devenu un autre, il avait été capable de se mettre à la place d'un autre.
So it means that for like a split second, this guy became someone else. He was able to put himself in the skin of someone else.
Et donc, c'est ça, être, pouvoir être à la place de quelqu'un d'autre.
And that's what being in somebody else's
shoes is. Et je crois que le cinéma, c'est une de ses vocations, c'est d'arriver à ce qu'un spectateur, homme, hétérosexuel, soit homosexuel.
And that's what I think cinema is about. It's about, for instance, you know, a heterosexual actor being able to be homosexual in a film. Mm-hmm.
Et une femme, un homme.
And a
un
woman,
noir, un blanc.
A man, a black, a white person.
C'est ça.
That's film.
It's a joke, but with a big
it's a joke, yes. But there's a seed of wisdom in
French,
it.
It was French.
No, in English it was very difficult to explain that. Yeah.
But that's, I think, the whole, I've been thinking about this more and more because of the interviews I do, because we do a couple hundred of these every year, and I don't put myself on camera, and I kind of, sometimes I wonder why, and then I realize that I'm kind of recreating the gaze of the camera in a film. Often it's with actors, not just directors, but I'm staring at you guys the way that the camera stares at an actor or person on camera. And that I get the opportunity to be part of it. Mm. I'm putting myself in the movie by being over here asking questions. But that watching your faces and having that experience is still, there's a delightful, fascinating intimacy to it that I crave, that I think is why I do the work I'm doing. So it's an interesting, there's always that, there's a chance to actually spend the time with inside of somebody, like really watching.
Yeah.
And you don't have to actually express the feelings about it as you're having them,
mm-hmm.
You know? That was a speech,
c'est,
more than a question.
C'est que,
it's not a question.
No,
it's not a question, yes.
C'est que lui, des fois, il se pose souvent la question parce qu'il se met dans la position où lui, il est en train de filmer les autres, mais qu'il en fait quand même partie. Et pourquoi est-ce que lui, il se met pas sous les yeux de la caméra? Mais que ça crée une des choses importantes du fait qu'il aime tellement ce travail, c'est qu'il y a un sentiment d'intimité qui se crée entre les personnes et dans cet échange.
Thank you.
Yeah. And the time we spend with your characters in your movies, similarly, it gives the audience a chance to breathe them in, and not just story.
No, see, it's a challenge. See, you build a story with dramatic accent, but we look at somebody, at a human being. And it's, without time, it's not possible. You have to take time to see somebody. And we try to to balance, to make balance, to between this time to look at being human and just an intrigue,
a dramatic plot. Structure.
Yeah. So when you guys are in the editing room, do you ever go too long? I mean, how do you work that, or is it just you just know instinctually? I mean, how does that?
We don't. No, we can't say we know, but the most important for us is the shooting. The key of the film is during the shooting, long takes, and when we are in the editing room, we have to choose
which long take,
huh? And the beginning and the end. And
the beginning for me, and like this,
to try to find the rhythm of the film.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, it's a good job. It's enough for us.
So you're making, you know, in the broader sense.
A lot of different versions. Huh?
A lot of different versions.
Yeah, yes. This time, yes, 20, more than 20, because.
So do they feel very different, or is it just a?
Yeah. No, it's a rhythm.
Yeah, it's a question of rhythm, of treatment, and sometimes it's easy. You believe that it will be easy to find, but no.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, and it was interesting because each time we went from the beginning of the film to the end for a week of work, mm-hmm, of editing, and then tack the Monday. We watch the version, mm-hmm, and we change. And the next Monday we do the same.
And just the two of you and the editor?
No, and the editor. Yes.
And the editor, yes, because we are three. It's good for us because she is very important. And she proposes something, some version, some cuts. Very important for us because it was in our imagination.
Mm.
No, she brings a lot of things.
But you're not showing it to other people, friends,
yes,
or are you?
Not in the beginning, but after 5 or 6 weeks, we make a screening for our friend Denis Fred, who is the co-producer of the film, and yes.
And then Finn Thompson.
So one or two people, not a lot.
Until now, it's enough. Until now.
Well, it's like Scorsese, we've talked about. They have a little screening room in the office, and they have 20 people, and they'll do that 10 times during the course of editing the film. But it sounds like you're...
The friends.
People who know each other and their trust and who, you know... And they're really, they're not asking questions so much as listening to how the audience feels.
Yes.
But not so much for
we
you.
We don't use this way. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's another way to work.
And do you still get nervous when you go to Cannes and you're going up the red carpet and you're waiting? Is it still nervous?
Yeah, it's the first screening for us in Cannes, and it was we were nervous. Yes, all times we are nervous. Yes, it's very hard to watch the film with the audience in Cannes for the first time. Mm-hmm. When we went to Cannes for the first time,
mm-hmm,
we believed we are just for the beginning, but after 10 minutes or 2 minutes we go out.
Mm-hmm.
No, you have to remain that, you stay that. It's terrible because we hear the chairs and it's terrible, terrible.
Do you ever feel good? Is it ever a nice thing that you're hearing people sigh or scream or cry or?
I don't know.
Yes, yes.
My body is there, but I'm not there.
So when do you feel relief, or do you feel relief ever? I mean, is there a moment where you go, where they're standing at the end, and you're going, okay, I think we're okay?
Yeah, at the end, it's nice when it's okay with the audience, uh-huh, yes, because every time the audience applauds, mm-hmm, but you feel the difference when the applause
polite
or if they like, love the film. And for this film, it was, we feel the love. They love the film. They love the film. Yet it was a good applause. Yes, it was very, well, a pleasure.
And will you watch it with an audience again after that, or are you now free to escape and never watch it again?
Nah. Well, no, we after the screening we escape. Yes.
And we.
And then we are with friends after that.
Mais il a dit après, est-ce que vous visionnez plus le film, vous arrêtez, ou est-ce que vous le
faites? Never. Only one time.
Sometimes when we teach, sometimes I teach at the university, and we teach in Berlin or in
It's not the same.
But and we have to show the movies too, because we talk about the movies.
But that's more scientific.
Something like that. Yes.
And does this process of going out and, you know, shaking hands and then kissing babies, as you release the movie across the world, has it become comfortable for you? Is this easier than that first screening?
The first screening in we were in Berlin and in Madrid in a Valladolid 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And the first screening is always a test, you know. Mm-hmm. And but when the test is good, we are happy. Mm-hmm. And if it's not the first screening, well, it's very different. Well, maybe somebody don't like the film. Why not? Well, mm-hmm. But for the first screening, it's always we are very nervous.
Do you read critics? Or are you very interested in that, or is that irrelevant?
Hmm? Est-ce que vous lisez les critiques, ou est-ce que ça n'a pas vraiment...
Some critics. Some
it depends.
Critics.
It depends.
Some critics. We read some critics.
He reads.
No. You too.
But you read, or do you read ones that you respect, or read ones that are quote unquote important?
No. It's difficult to explain exactly because I don't give names of critics. But sometimes it's good, it's important to read a critic because he sees, he watched something what you done.
He saw something.
Different perspective.
Yes. Something you and did. It's interesting. Yes, okay.
That's the most interesting.
Yes. And sometimes it happens. It's in America and in Europe. In mm-hmm. France, US, and UK. The three. Mm-hmm. Because we have some critics in this countries, and they are important for us.
Are there any films that you've made that have become very different, or it seems the reaction to what seems the idea of what they are is different than what you guys intended when you made it, when all the criticism kind of settles in?
It's difficult to answer, but no, I don't have any memory about that. A big gap between our nos intentions et puis ce qu'il en passe. No. No, I don't remember. No. But all is possible, obviously. Mm-hmm. But the most interesting is what Luc told. When you have somebody else who accompanies your work, it's a kind of friend, if you want, huh? Mm-hmm. Even if he is not a friend. In it's a kind of a compagnon
yeah, it's a road companion. Not voyage, you know,
even if you don't know him,
a traveling companion, even if you don't know him.
In this way, it's important, but it's the most important.
And it's very important to have a friend of journey who does. To tell you it's not good for me this moment, why? Because and if you trust in him, you accept. Mm-hmm. If you accept, it's not easy, but yes, okay, maybe yeah, maybe it's too construct, it's too built. Mm-hmm. It's right. The film is made, it's too late. But for the next, yes.
I always find that when I have very strong feelings about a film, particularly negative ones, but often sometimes positive ones, that I usually represent a side in the conversation. Then the end, 40% or 35% or 60% or whatever are going to agree with me. And then there's going to always be that group that has a different view, regardless of what you're, you know what I mean? There's no answer to a movie, I don't think. It's always perspective.
Il n'y a jamais vraiment de réponse à un film, c'est toujours une question de perspective.
Yeah, because when the film is on the screen, he's also the film of these people, of these people, of these people, and you begin a kind of conversation with the film, and it's your conversation. And if your film is strong enough to accept this kind of conversation, that's a good film. Because sometimes it's the same with the novels. Sometimes it's impossible to have a conversation with a novel because it's closed, absolutely closed. And our challenge is to try also to make film they are stay open, to have a conversation with everyone in the audience. And we will see.
You guys have done pretty well in this regard. No?
Vous avez bien réussi de ce point de
vue-là. Well, no, it's difficult to say that.
It's your opinion is more important than our opinion. But we hope, yes, we hope. But the owner, when you make a film and you release a film, the film owns to the viewer, à partir du spectateur,
oui. Owns
to the viewer, to the audience.
Belongs.
Belongs, yes. And yes, the owner is a spectator, but it is very. But it's important for me. I like to hear from a spectator, from a viewer, his opinion, his critics, because I feel the. He's not at the same place than me, than I. And he speak from another country, from another. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's interesting, very, very interesting.
Yeah. It's like talking about your kids.
Yeah.